starting on time. Thank you very much for coming. I don't know if you've been to our training sessions before, but this is our ninth training session, and it's very special. Is everyone comfortable? Does everyone have what they want to eat? Okay. In 1992, Virginia law required every county and city in Virginia to establish a local disability services board to provide input to state agencies regarding services, needs, and priorities of a person with a physical and sensual disability. The boards were to be a resource for local government regarding the ADA and provide other assistance and advice as requested. The Hampton Roads Disability Services Board, which we were, was able to grant awards to several programs and projects. In 2009, we lost all of our funding, and several disability services boards in Virginia closed their doors, but we did not. In 2010, we won a grant, and with the assistance of each of our five cities, we were able to successfully sponsor a one-day symposium entitled Leadership for Employment of Americans with Disabilities in Local Government. A training video for employing persons with disabilities was created and distributed to each disability services board throughout the state and related agencies. And we went on from there. We changed our name from the South Hampton Roads Disability Services to Hampton Roads Disabilities Board. We expanded our focus from physical sensory disabilities to all disabilities. We have invited all cities and counties in the Hampton Roads region to our table and are searching for additional volunteers. We now represent our five cities plus James City County. Our board has become an information resource for all persons of Hampton Roads and beyond. The Hampton Roads Disabilities Board welcomes you to our ninth workshop that relates to the ADA. Everyone here is here to learn for his own purpose, whether to gain knowledge to improve services for your clients who are disabled, gain more knowledge of your legal rights as a person with a disability, address ADA building code exit codes for your job or place of business so you can avoid legal problems over non-compliance with the law. But there is one result everyone here will walk out with: a better understanding of how persons with disabilities can be integrated into society as productive citizens, and how you can better identify discriminatory practices that act as barriers and hopefully do something about it. I learned about the ADA before it became law. I'm a designer. I've always believed, every home and community should be accessible for everyone. I was invited to a lunch with the late Alan Rothman of HUD and Bill Mitchell, an attorney and advocate for accessibility, at a housing design conference at North Carolina State University in the early 1990s. They introduced me to Section 504 and the forthcoming ADA Act that had not been signed yet. Knowing how I felt about access and housing, they suggested I get on the list for training on ADA that was being formed at Tidewater. Steve Johnson, who you'll meet later, was the manager of the Independence Center, and they were creating the list. He put my name on the first federal training held in Virginia that there were only 75 people taken when the law was signed in 1990. I think that's where I met Marion, and I know that's where I met Maureen Hollowell, which you will meet later. They were in that class too. It was sponsored by the Disabilities Rights Educational and Defense Fund. All trainers were committed to train as many people as possible across Virginia. I am still training, and have been doing so way beyond the state of Virginia since 1992. The Americans with Disabilities Act, signed 25 years ago, is a civil rights law that bans discrimination against our nation's people with mental and physical disabilities in virtually every aspect of American life. The ADA consists of five titles covering federal, state, local, and private places that are open to the public, businesses, services, transportation, schools, and telecommunications, assuring that people with disabilities have the same rights and opportunities as everyone else. Those protected by the ADA include those with physical and mental impairments that substantially limit the major life activities such as walking, hearing, breathing, caring for oneself, learning, seeing, and go on, and everything else. ADA also protects those who have a record of having a disability, but who has recovered, and also those who are regarded as having a disability, even though they don't have one, assuming they have been discriminated against because of that disability. The titles and its production continue to be enhanced, incorporating the latest technologies, bringing the ADA into the future as they affect everyone. Changes take place, but it takes 25 years, and we've been, in this time, we have been effective, successful, and a model for all countries. National education and training for everyone, such as this program, is one of the reasons the law is so effectively enforced. Today, we continue our efforts of the Hampton Roads Disabilities Board to educate you. And it is a great pleasure that I introduce Marion Vessels, Director of Mid-Atlantic ADA Center, a member of the ADA National Network, operated by Transcend Incorporated. They provide information, guidance, and training on the Americans with Disabilities Act in DC, Delaware, Maryland, Pennsylvania, Virginia, and West Virginia. Today, you will be trained to understand Title III of the ADA. Marion was the state ADA coordinator for 7 years after the ADA was signed. Among her primary areas of expertise are training and guidance on ADA as it relates to employment, state and local governments, arts, and hospitality. May I present Marion Vessel.
Men's and women's rooms are right there. Please feel free to get up and move around if you need to and use the facilities as needed. We will not be taking a formal break during the morning session. So if you need to get up and move around, please do so. I think those are my important must-haves and must-dos. All righty then, let's get started. We did hand out the PowerPoint if you need it, and we can email it to you after the fact. That would make it easier for you. So we'll make sure that that happens. We're going to do a quick quiz, so if you've got the handouts, turn them over. You don't want to cheat. Multiple choice. If you live to the age of 70, the chance of having a disability is A, 12%, B, 28%, C, 55%, and D, 82%. What do you all think? D, I got some D's. What else? C's. Anyone else? Okay. The C's happen, 55%. Think about that, 55%. Almost 57 million people. And this is a number documented by the U.S. Census Bureau. So that's people who raised their hand and said, I have a disability, to the federal government. How many of you know people that would never admit that they have a disability to the federal government? Yeah, both hands, right? A lot of people would not want to go on record as having a disability for any number of reasons. So these are people who said they did. So we know this number is very low, right? So this is the minimal number of people with disabilities. So you can only imagine what the real number is. A substantial, and that is 1 in 5 people having a disability. We're going to do a quick kind of consideration of what people with disabilities may be. A lot of times people think, oh, people with disabilities are those people. They're not me. And we're going to have you become part of this group. So on the screen, we have a variety of different people identified by little cartoons. And I want you to pick out one of those characters. And we're going to age that cohort. So we've got 15 to 24 years old. And you can see that there are 5 people with disabilities. And then we're going to go to 25 to 44. How many of you developed a disability in that as you age? Nobody yet, okay? 45 to 54. We got a few more people. Anybody get a disability now? A few of you? Okay, a couple? Pardon? No one's admitting it. Yeah, it's probably not. No one's admitting it, right? 55 to 64, we've got more. Anybody? So we've got 4 or 5 people now who've raised their hand. And then we've got 55 to 64. Anybody get a disability now? Raise their hand that didn't before. We've got a couple of more. Okay. And then look at this change, 65 to 69. That's still a lot of people in the workforce right now, right? A lot of people didn't retire. Their 401ks tanked, whatever. They want to stay active. So we got 37% of the population now has a disability. And 70 to 74%. Anybody gain? We've got a couple more. 75 to 79. Look at that volume. We've got more than half of the population, 55%, almost 56%, now has a disability. So you can see, as you age, people are going to be developing disabilities, and not just due to what we normally think of, well, I can't see as well or hear as well, but they're going to be developing a variety of disabilities. So that gives you a little bit of a sense of what the ADA is looking at in terms of volume of people with disabilities. Now, Shirley kind of alluded to this in the beginning a little bit. What is the ADA? You know, we still get questions that say, the American Dental Association? Or American Diabetes? It's like, no, 25 years. We just, July 26, 1990, we celebrated our 25th anniversary of signing of the ADA. Now, Shirley indicated, and there are a few people. Anyone here in the room attend? You attended? Shirley? So there's three of us in the room. That's pretty cool. That attended the signing of the ADA. 29 years ago, a very, very hot day on the lawn of the White House. The largest signing of any law to date, because it was so important for people with disabilities. So 25 years later, who would have thought we'd still be talking about the basics of the ADA? But here we are. It's still important for folks to know and to be able to understand. I'd like to take a quick poll in the room. How many of you, raise your hands, consider yourselves to be advocates? Raise your hand. You got it. About 25 people in the room. How many of you would consider yourself a service provider? About 25, 30 people. How many state and local government people? So we've got about 12, 15. How many business people? We've got about 8, 10. Any category I missed? Okay, good. So that kind of gives you a sense of who the audience is. Now, the ADA is a piece of civil rights legislation. And if you remember nothing else about what I talk about today, it's really important for you to remember that ADA is civil rights. It's not a building code. It doesn't just talk about access to a building or parking or toilets or anything like that. We will talk about those things. It's not just access to goods and services, but it's that whole concept of civil rights. And it's across a variety of spectrums. And the goal of the ADA was full inclusion of people with disabilities into American society. And 25 years ago, that did not happen. I'll tell you a quick story about a place of public accommodation. When the ADA was being passed, they asked people with disabilities to do a discrimination diary and send it to Congress. Because Congress at the time said, we don't need an ADA. Americans with disabilities are just like every American. They all have civil rights. So they don't need a special law. And people with disabilities said, oh, not so. We really, really do need the ADA. So they sent in discrimination diaries, things that they could not do on a daily basis. Like they couldn't go grocery shopping easily. They couldn't pump their own gas. They couldn't get into a restaurant. They couldn't spend the night in a hotel. They couldn't get access to basic goods and services. They couldn't tell when the emergency alert came over the TV screen. All kinds of things were not accessible to them. And they asked one young woman from the Midwest to come and testify in front of Congress. And she was in high school, and she went to the movies with her friends one night on Friday night. She stood in line, she had her money in hand, and when she got to the ticket taker, happened to be the owner of the theater that night. And he looked at her and said, "You can't come in." And she, like many of you, would, "Why not? You know, I'm standing in line, I've got my money." He said, "I don't like the way you look." She happened to have cerebral palsy. She was ambulatory, but she moved differently and spoke differently. And because of her disability alone that night, she had to go home. There was no law, a federal law, state law, local law, that said that was unfair, that that was unjust. That's what we're here today about. The ADA now says that that would be illegal, that they couldn't do it based on a disability factor alone, especially when there was no physical access requirements. But we'll talk about sometimes you can't overcome physical access issues, depending on the facility of the site. But remember, that's what we're here today, the integration of people with disabilities across the wide variety of spectrum. So ADA, so why is the ADA needed? Most of you in the room probably might remember 1990. And if you did, you do, you remember that there weren't a lot of curb cuts. Most businesses were not accessible. You rarely saw anybody with a disability in a TV show, right? Or in the movies. And if you did, they were probably one of two things. They were probably either the hero or the villain, right? They were amazing because they were in a wheelchair and they could live normally. Or they were Captain Hook and they were evil. And there really wasn't much in between. You just didn't see people with disabilities normally going about their business. You rarely saw interpreters at events. And you just didn't see people with disabilities out and about. It was too hard to get out and about. The people just didn't. Public transportation wasn't accessible. Private transportation wasn't accessible. So there was lots of reasons you didn't see people. Come to common day, normal day today. Curb cuts everywhere, right? We kind of expect to see accessible bathrooms, accessible services, transportation. You see interpreters at all kinds of public events. You know, we now have interpreters at rock concerts. How cool is that? And symphonies. We have all kinds of ways we can integrate people with disabilities. And that is through the beginning. This is a quick legislative timeline. This is kind of give you a sense. We have the Civil Rights Act of 1964. It did not include people with disabilities. It included a lot of other folks, but not people with disabilities. But we based the ADA on the Civil Rights Act of 1964. We had the Architectural Barriers Act that talked about access to federal government facilities. We have the Rehabilitation Act of 1973 that talks about funding for federal projects, and if you got federal monies, you had to become accessible. But it wasn't really all that effective. But we based a lot of the basis of the ADA on that as well. We had IDEA, Education for Children with Disabilities, Air Carrier Access Act, and Fair Housing Act. And that was the basis for those two types of entities. So they were not included in the ADA because we already had those laws. And then we had the ADA in 1990, And then we'll talk a little bit about the ADA Amendments Act in 2008 that had to rectify some of the decisions that the Supreme Court made that Congress felt was not in accordance with what they wanted to see the ADA to be. You can see how we built upon past history. As Shirley indicated, the ADA's definition of disability is three-pronged. The first one is an individual who has a disability, it's a physical or mental impairment that substantially limits a major life activity. And so that's a lot of things that you can think about generally, and we'll get into that. An individual has a record of a disability. So somebody who may not have that disability currently, but has a record of that disability could be discriminated against. And the third one is even more challenging for many people to kind of understand. It is somebody who by association or is regarded as. I had a friend that had a severe facial scar from a kitchen fire. And people thought that she had a disability because she had a scar on her face. Now, it didn't impact anything that she did. You know, she could still see and hear and everything else. But people said, oh, because that scar, you know, we think you have a disability, we're not going to hire you. So even though she didn't have a disability, she was protected under the law because people regarded her. Also, by association, we've had parents who've been discriminated against. Parents of kids with disabilities who, when they applied for a job, said, oh, I know you have a child with severe disabilities. And so I know you're going to take a lot of time for work. And because of that, we're not going to hire you. There's no evidence that they were going to need to take a lot of time for work, but the presumption by the association, they were discriminated against. They themselves did not have a disability. So it was very clever, those who wrote the ADA, to think about not only people with disabilities, but these two additional categories. Okay, I mentioned the ADA Amendments Act. Its overall purpose was to restore the intent of the ADA, the Congress Act. And those regulations went into effect in 2011. And they made the ADA a little bit more expansive. And I want you to think back. What five activities, different activities, did you do to get here today? Some examples would be seeing and hearing. Think about those in a couple seconds. What kind of examples, and here I'm going to ask you to shout it out, and I'll repeat it. So what kind of things did you do?
Drive
is not necessarily an activity of daily living, because you can live without driving, right? A lot of people do. No, maybe not in this area. And then the Mid-Atlantic region in general, because we don't have great public transportation, but most people don't necessarily have to. Shower, activities of daily living, right? You brush your teeth.
Get dressed.
What else? Getting here, talking to people, communicating. I imagine most of you ate. Those are all activities of daily living. So here's some major life activities that we. Sorry, I lost my mic. That we just talked about. Caring for oneself, manual tasks, seeing, hearing, eating, sleeping, walking, standing, lifting, bending. Those are all kind of things we do, most of us, on a daily basis, right? We talk about communicating, thinking, learning, reading, concentrating, interacting with others, reaching, working, speaking, all major life activities. Now, under the Amendments Act, we've got this great expansion, as I mentioned, which is really exciting. Now, only an ADA geek would say, this is really exciting, major bodily functions. But it's true. These are now defined in the law that hadn't been before. So now we're talking about the immune system. We're talking about digestion and bowel, bladder, brain, circulatory, cardiovascular, neurological. All of those things are considered now to be part of the definition of ADA. Things as, such as respiratory and endocrine systems and lymphatic, musculoskeletal, reproductive, genitourinary. All of those things are now defined under the law. Because we had judges who were saying that people with cancer didn't have disabilities. Or you had to show more and more and more evidence of your disability. And that wasn't the intent of the law. We also have another new standard, which is also equally exciting, and that's episodic. Episodic. So something that happens occasionally, but is not constantly there. And examples of that would be epilepsy and hypertension and multiple sclerosis and depression and bipolar disorder, anxiety, cancer, diabetes, asthma. All of those are episodic. They're not always there necessarily all the time. And in prior iterations of the law, you had to look at the person without, as they would be without any enhancements or medications or supports. So you looked at me with my wheelchair, and was I disabled? And the answer would be no. So now the new standard is you look at them without any of those supports. So without my wheelchair, I'm spinal cord injured, and I'm paralyzed from my chest down. So without my wheelchair, am I disabled? Yeah. I mean, I'd be a little worm on the ground. I really wouldn't be effective as a trainer, would I? But with my wheelchair, I can do an awful lot of things, and I can drive down here from Baltimore and, you know, be able to train and be able to do my job. So now we're looking at people with those supports. And do they have a disability still? Yeah, because we're looking at without those supports. Do they have disability? With something with episodic, we're looking at them with when the disease is at its height. So for episodic, so if they're in full-blown asthma or their MS is aggravated or their epilepsy is out of control, we look at it that way. Because this allows us to do preventative measures. So if, for MS, if you know that the heat of the day is really, really impactful, then maybe you can flex your schedule and work in the cooler part of the day and be able to be home in an air conditioning when it's hotter. So this is wonderful. This is a great boon for people with disabilities in order to be able to use the law and do preventative things in order to assure that their disability doesn't flare up. We have a quick question. Oh, hang on. What did you mean? We need to get a microphone to you. No, we need a microphone. Let me turn it on.
Someone without, saying that they do not have a disability or have a disability without the equipment or whatever they need to use and put that disability?
Well, what the goal is to say, before the law was an interpretation of Supreme Court decision said, you would look at me with my wheelchair and would I still be disabled? Most of the time people would still say yes. But if you looked at somebody maybe with hypertension or with asthma with their medication, they may not have a flare-up because they're taking medication. But we want them to take medication, right, to keep their asthma under control. But there may be side effects to that medication that we're going to need to accommodate. And we're going to want to do different things to assure that the disease doesn't flare up. So we still need to make sure that those factors are in place. So that's why you look at without that. Okay, we've got one more quick question. Right here in the front. It's coming. There you go.
Does that same criteria apply to people with a mental disability?
Absolutely. As we said, with people with major depression or bipolar or other types of mental disabilities that have a tendency to fluctuate. You know, not everybody's in a heightened state of depression. Sometimes it comes and goes. Bipolar, anxiety, all of those kinds of things may come and go. But we want to make sure that people have the supports they need in place in order to be effective. So the ADA has got five different titles or groupings. One's employment, Title II, state, local government. Title III is private businesses or places, public accommodations. Title IV is telecommunications. And Title V is miscellaneous. Now, had they asked me, I would have said that's a really bad title. Miscellaneous doesn't tell you much, right? But what I would really like to have seen was transportation be a heading. Because transportation is buried under Title II and III, depending on who provides it. But I think it's a really critical aspect of people with disabilities' lives that needed to be highlighted. But these are the five titles, and then we're going to be talking specifically about Title III. Now I'm going to give you, I'm going to do this short video. It is not audio described, so I will audio describe it for you. But it's a British video that I think gives you an interesting sense about how we want to have our mindset today as we talk about the ADA. And there's a man with an umbrella and it's raining. And he's trying to put his umbrella up. There's two women coming up. And one says, do you need any help in sign language? And he just looks at her. And she signs to her friend, and she's fine signs. Never mind. So then he yells for a taxi, and the taxi drives by, and another one, an accessible taxi drives by. His umbrella didn't work, so he's running, and he's drenched. And he gets to the front door, and there's a lift on the outside of the building that says, please push for assistance.
I'm like a very brave.
And the man is saying, he thinks he's very brave, has a short arm. So he's thinking he's brave because of his able-bodiedness.
I am Robert Kingsley. I'm here for the
interview.
Yes, sorry, I'm late. I couldn't.
I'm sure that's okay.
Taxi.
Now this woman has a short arm as well.
So I can't come.
And they shouldn't be on.
No, I just
come. You're welcome.
She just handed him the application in Braille. And that's why he couldn't read it. Now the interview panel is all people with disabilities and they're whispering, he's able-bodied.
How good of you to come. Why don't you take a seat? Now take as much time as you need.
Then there's a service animal underneath the table. And he's going back down a little bit.
I'm afraid of all these things once. Great.
Okay, so you can kind of see role reversal, right? What life would be like if everyone else had a disability and you didn't. Okay, we're going to be talking about Title III places of public accommodations. The basic standard for Title III is places of public accommodation cannot deny people with disabilities goods or services. They need to be creative of ways that they can do it. We're going to talk about how that may happen. So what are places of public accommodation? Why don't you just holler out some that you think of, and I'll go through the categories for you. So what do you think are places of public accommodation? Restaurants, hospitals, free clinics, libraries, but depending on who runs them. You know, this is a public library, so what would this be covered under? Title II, right? Other examples? Stores, museums, depending on who runs them. Grocery stores, absolutely. Hospitals, depending on who runs them, absolutely. So, some of the places of public accommodation, number one, are hotels, inns, motels, places of lodging. The second category is restaurant, bars, or other places that serve food and drink. Things that we go to, and that includes, you know, fast food places. Motion picture theaters, you mentioned theaters, concert halls, stadiums, places of exhibits or entertainment are all considered to be, again, depending on who runs them. So you always have to know who owns the facility, because some of these could actually be Title II, right? Auditorium or convention center or lecture hall, any kind of place of public gathering. A lot of times there's auditoriums that you can rent. Many of you said stores, so bakery, grocery stores, clothing stores, the malls, shopping center, places where you go and purchase goods or services. And that can include doctor's offices, lawyers, all of those kind of things. Laundromat, dry cleaners, banks, barbershops, beauty shops, gas stations, professional offices like the doctors and lawyers, hospitals, any place that gives you a service that's open to the public would be covered under the ADA. Transportation, as we mentioned earlier, if it's provided by a local business or a national business as opposed to government. So taxis that are private, that are not part of, regulated by the government. Right now, Uber would be considered under that. Greyhound, a lot of the bus companies that you can contract would be considered transportation. You all mentioned museums and galleries and places where you see collections of art and artifacts and things like that. A park or a zoo or amusement park, King's Dominion, you know, would be considered a place of public accommodation. Or other recreational facilities, golf courses, all kinds of things. Mini golf, all those kind of things would be considered, they're owned by a private company. And that's where people get a lot of confusion. Places of public accommodation are ones that are owned by the private sector. The public in public accommodation is not state and local government, but it's we the public who attend it. So that's how you kind of need to remember it. Also, some people said schools. And so you're thinking, you know, a lot of times, you know, nursery schools. But there are also a lot of private schools that would be covered under the ADA. The only exemption would be religious schools that are owned and operated by religious entities. and they are not covered under the ADA. And they're not covered because we have that separation of church and state, right? So those are considered separate. Now, there's all kinds of other standards. If they receive federal funds, then they have to provide access. If they receive state and local government funds, then they're going to have to provide some access. Where's your microphone?
The school to the public, then if not, they are not related to the religious institution.
Exactly. So a lot of times, church or school, religious school entities would rent their facilities, and then they would have to comply with the ADA because they're open to the public, and in that aspect, we have something back here.
Question, when you said that if it's a public accommodation where it's a privately owned, but it rents out it's the building for weddings or whatever, they are responsible for accommodating people that may be attending with a disability?
Well, attending is a really good question. We're going to talk about effective communication. So let's say this was, as an example, right where we are today, if this was a private library and we were renting space in it, the library in the rental agreement would probably say, we will provide physical access, able to get you in, toilet facilities, things like that. But the sponsoring entity would be responsible for interpreters and for providing large print or braille if needed or whatever else, whatever kind of effective communication. So usually there's contractual obligation that an entity has. But in terms of physical access, yes. If you're renting out a private religious entities, and if it's a lot of churches will rent out their meeting hall for the public to be able to purchase it and hold events there, then they have the obligation to provide that physical access.
So the reason I asked, I went to a wedding that, in my opinion, did not have any access for anybody with a disability, nor did the people have to walk so far or try to get an elevator. It was nothing out there. So you're saying the people that sponsored that wedding, that rented that place, should have been responsible for providing, making sure that there was access for people that were disabled.
Well, what you're talking about really is the people who held the wedding.
Yes.
Made the decision that facility accommodated what they want. So they had options to go to probably more accessible places or not.
I don't think they thought about that, of course, to my son. I just don't think that he thought about that there were his grandmother was going to be there with him, was disabled, and other people were going to come. But I just wanted that, if I understand you correctly, if I was giving something at a public and I rented the place, then after I read the contract and everything, I should look at myself, who might be coming, and try to make arrangements or look around and see how that would work. Is that what you're saying?
Absolutely. You, as the sponsor, have that obligation. So when you hold events, you know, we do a major conference. We're going to be doing an ADA conference here in Virginia in the spring. It is our obligation to try and find as an accessible a facility as we can. And there's lots of parameters that happen. But that is our obligation to be able to find the event the event setting that works the best for us, based on what we anticipate the audience to be. Does that help?
Well, I just wanted to know. I thought about it. Excuse me. I'm so sorry. I thought about that, and then the reason I told you I'm sure you didn't think about it is because I remember my sister was in a wheelchair. I parked her in the grocery store and I said, I'll be right back, and forgot. And so I went shopping. When I looked around later, I said, where she is? She was back there where I parked her. And so, you know, if you're not used to people with disabilities, sometimes you have to make a cognitive, you have to be aware and make a cognitive effort to think about it. And I know my son wanted his grandmother here, but he never thought about, I think, that she had a wheelchair or cane and all that.
Absolutely. So those are the kind of things we're going to be talking about is doing a facility access survey to make sure that facilities are accessible for the kind of things you want to do. So the 11th category is daycare centers, senior centers, homeless shelters, food banks, adoption agencies, and social service centers. There's lots of them now, right? We have centers for disabled vets. Just all kinds of service centers are going to be covered under the ADA. And the last one is exercise places, gyms, health spas, bowling alley, golf courses, exercise, recreation, all of those that are owned by the private sector are also going to be included in provisions of the ADA. Now, you wonder, kind of, we've got these 12 categories. How did they come up with that? Literally, the congressional aides that were helping to draft this opened up the yellow pages. And these were the categories that they felt best identified the services that we use in everyday society. So that's what we have. It could be that a business has facilities that isn't open to the public. And if they're not open to the public, they would not be covered under the Title III provisions of the ADA. Here's the microphone for you.
With something like the Spirited Notebook, would that fall under transportation or would that fall under the poverty section?
The Spirit of Norfolk is what? I'm sorry.
Would that be a private?
Oh, it's a ship that you can insure. Yeah, I'm presuming it's owned privately.
I'm not sure.
That would be my guess. That head's nodding that it is. Since I'm not from here, I'm not familiar with everything. But as a private entertainment thing that you would tour, to the best of their ability. Now, obviously, a ship can be very challenging, and there can be a lot of places where maybe a wheelchair user would not be able to get onto. But to the best of the extent that they can, they must provide access.
Thank you.
Yes,
you know, the healthcare facilities are assumed to be in the ADA, but I don't see a lot of information that requires them to be responsible for their rehabilitative facilities. We have an awful lot here in our region that are not accessible. I hear people saying all the time that they have difficulty getting in for rehab. Can you address that?
Certainly. They were covered, as you saw, you know, as a service provider. And it's a continuing problem. You will see under the Department of Justice settlement agreements, there's a huge number. A lot of them around effective communication because doctors and medical professionals, hospitals don't provide interpreters or interpreter services. But also, you'll see that as we move into looking more aggressively at medical facilities, there is a whole thing that the Access Board and the Department of Justice are looking at for medical equipment, tables that raise and lower, mammogram machines that are accessible to women with physical disabilities. Just the access into rehabilitation facilities and doctor's offices, getting in and out of the exam rooms, getting in and off of x-ray tables, all of those things are now being really aggressively pursued and looked at. We're looking on our website, we hope to do in the next 6 months or so, start to coalesce medical resources, healthcare resources that people could look at, that will talk to standards and resources on how to make sure that businesses are fully accessible. You know, the Department of Justice will say that they don't get a lot of complaints other than effective communication around physical access for medical facilities. And so they have recently undertaken a campaign with their assistant attorneys general in the across the country to look at healthcare as an issue. So it is rising to the top of the food chain as far as enforcement. So I think we'll be finding more and more enforcement around the healthcare facilities in general.
Thank you. There was another question back here.
Do you have any information on service dogs on ships?
Service dogs on ships? What yeah. kind of ships?
The Navy ship. You know, the work ships.
You're probably talking more employment?
Yes.
Okay. Well, let's talk about that later. We're going to talk about service animals in general, but if you have a specific question around employment, I'll talk to you about that. Okay? All right. Okay. Under Title III requirements, a business must look at their policies, practices, and procedures and modify them to include people with disabilities, unless it would be a fundamental alteration that it would change the way they do business. An example of this might be Borders Bookstore. Excuse me, I'm getting over a cold, so I apologize. My voice is a little froggy and I'm a little bit of a cough. Borders Bookstores does not have to provide all of their books in Braille and in audiobooks. Because that would be a fundamental alteration of what they do. That would change the nature of their business. So because of that, they would not have to do it under the ADA. But if it's providing a ramp, if it's providing someone assistance in reaching something, we'll get into all these examples, then they must do so as a point of business. So here are the Title III requirements. We've got architectural accessibility. So anything built after March 2012 has to comply with the 2010 standards. And that's pretty exciting because 2010 standards were adapted from the 1991 standards because we learned a lot of lessons in those standards. We learned that interestingly enough, we had too many wheelchair spaces in places of stadiums and auditoriums. So baseball stadiums and football stadiums had a large number of wheelchair accessible seats that took up a lot of space because it takes up 1.5 to 2 spaces for every wheelchair seating. And they found that a lot of those seats were going unused. So we didn't want those seats not used. That just didn't make sense, right? So they reduced the number of seats required based on usage patterns. But they did do some things that were really cool, like, you know, normally clubs are almost on the floor. You know, they're really low, hard for a lot of people to reach. They raised it up. Light switches that were pretty high. They lowered them to make them more accessible to people with disabilities. So there's a lot of new things that happen. More wheelchair accessible spaces and van accessible spaces. We're talking a bit about this. So the 2010 standard was really pretty exciting because it made some great changes. What happened was that if you complied with the 1991 standard, you didn't have to come up to the 2010 standard unless you made any specific changes. But the 2010 standard was pretty exciting. What every business must need to do, and this is a challenge for them, is that they need to provide readily achievable barrier removal in existing facilities. So what do we mean by that? So you've got a convenience store, and they have a tendency to have lots of stuff stuffed in, right? They have those end caps where they have all these displays. It's almost impossible if you're a wheelchair user or even pushing a shopping cart to be able to make those turns or a baby carriage. But under the law, a wheelchair trumps those as far as gets demand for providing accessibility. So can that business be made more accessible? Yeah, they can remove those end caps or make sure they're not intruding into the clear floor space. They'll say, oh, but we need it for, we need to sell more things, and this helps sell. But they also have to provide full access for people to be able to wheelchair around. So that would be readily achievable. Putting in a ramp for a business that may only have one step might be readily achievable. Putting in maybe better lighting so people can around and see things better. There's a variety of examples we could probably come up with. That would be readily achievable, easy to do, as the Department of Justice says, without much difficulty or expense. And that's kind of their standard. That's really kind of what they use as the basis for their benchmark for what is readily achievable. Without much difficulty or expense. And that's an existing facility. And this is an ongoing obligation. You don't just do it once. They may say, well, we don't have the money to do it now. But if the economy improves in 6 months, then they must do it. So it doesn't ever go away. It's not a one-shot deal. And a lot of businesses don't appreciate that. And this also means an effective communication. So they can remove the effective communication barrier by providing materials in large print or having an interpreter needed. All of that is required of the ADA. So how accessible is a facility? These are the primary features we're going to be talking about. We're talking about parking, the entrance, the service area, where you go to get the goods and services, the restroom, and then if there's any amenities in the facility like water fountains or vending machines or telephones, although, you know, now they don't really have telephones much anymore, do we? But you might have a kiosk where you go to get services or the ATM, all of those would be covered. So what is the simple test for usability by the Department of Justice? Can you park? Can you enter the building? Can you participate in the programs and activities? And can you access the amenities? And that's all the things you want to make sure a person with a disability can do. Okay, parking, as you indicated at the wedding, you know, you can drop the grandma off at the door. But we want to make sure that the parking spaces are nearest to the accessible route to the entrance. They must be at least 8 foot wide with an access aisle. And they must have proper signage. And the surface is smooth and level. And I'll be able to go into great detail a little bit. But you can see here at the library, they've got a lot of very accessible spaces just to the side, which is the closest to the citizens. They're well-defined, there's a nice, safe, easy route. It's smooth and it's level, so it's easy to use. It's it's got to be slip resistant, stable and firm, so you can't use gravel in order to make sure that people can get in, because those with wheelchairs or walkers or canes can have a very difficult time with an unstable surface. The changes in level can't be any more than a quarter to an inch and a half an inch. Those that are that high must be beveled with a slope that's no greater than 1 and 2. So for every inch of height, you're going to have a foot of ramp. Okay? And changes that are greater than a half an inch must have a ramp. Just a half an inch. So it has to have a little beveled area so that people can get over it. The entrance door must be accessible. And that's a challenge for folks because outer doors don't have the requirement that inner doors do for being lightweight. But it must be accessible for people. So a lot of times, if it's not easy to get into, maybe a doorbell to allow people to ring and let them know that they're there to be able to get entrance. Signage must be placed at the front entrance. If that front entrance is not accessible, and a lot of private businesses, there may be steps, the grade may be difficult, there may be difficulties in getting in. So how do people know that there's an accessible entrance? I can tell you when I first moved to Washington and I was trying to get into a federal building, I got there and there was this huge flight of steps. And I was certain, it's a federal building, there must be, you know, an accessible entrance, but I couldn't figure out why. Well, many of you know, a federal building could be the whole block, right? One building is the whole block. And it was a really hot summer day. And I was in my manual chair, and I turned right. What the heck? Kept going around, and going around, and going around, and going around. Got almost to the front again and realized accessible entrance fell up. But it was hidden by bushes. There was no signage. And I had no way of knowing that that accessible entrance was there. Signage is the cheapest and easiest thing that folks can do to make it accessible. Another example, when I worked in state government, I was with the state of Maryland and I was their ADA coordinator. We got a complaint about a state building that someone said was inaccessible. Somebody in a wheelchair called up the front desk and said, I need to come to that building to have a wheelchair ramp. And the woman at the front desk said, no, we don't. We had just spent $10,000 making sure that building was fully accessible, putting in a beautiful new ramp. But it was on the side of the building that she never saw. And we didn't have signage in the front that says where it was. So she walked up those front steps. She never knew, and no one told her that we did. So we got a complaint filed against us, and we were fully accessible. But we didn't have the signage, and we didn't do staff training to make sure that everybody knew that we were fully accessible and what the options were. So signage is cheap and easy. It is the best way to make sure that people know what the access is. So as you can see in this example, if this is like a 7-Eleven and it has an ice machine, and it shows how you can become fully accessible by making sure that path of travel is accessible to people. I'm sure many of you, like I have, get to a building and they'll have newspaper stands, or they'll have, again, exhibits and goods and services out there. They'll have plants. They'll have planters that are right in front of the building so that you really can't get to the door. All of those things could be readily, cheaply relocated. I spent a lot of time talking to businesses about moving planters so I can push the access button to be able to open the door. It's hidden behind, we have a question here.
Curbs.
Wait. Have it right there. Don't worry.
I don't have a question. I want to make a comment. Curbs are so much in the way. I do have disabled children and a deaf child, and their curbs, no matter how wide the access to the parking is, you've got to go around the place. And most all, especially that, you know, mini marts and all, there's curbing where they want to keep the cars from running into the building, but it blocks the wheelchairs.
Oh, so they put a parking barrier that keeps you from using the curb cuts. So a lot of times, yeah, people just don't think about the space that is needed to allow for full access. And again, you know, what makes good sense for people with disabilities also can make really good sense for a number of people. You know, somebody using a walker or a stroller or a cart, you know, that they push to and from their homes to be able to walk to their local stores. All of the wheelchair accessible features are also really good for folks without disabilities. So it's good universal design, but we have to constantly remind businesses that they have to keep those features open and usable by people with disabilities. And so I challenge all of you, as you go about your day-to-day, stop and make comments, make suggestions. You can give them our phone number, you can give them the SILS phone number. We're going to have people from the Center for Independent Living at lunchtime will be talking about their services to be able to make sure that your neighborhoods, the places you go to, become accessible. I know my husband says, do we really have to tell them what's wrong with their bathroom before we just leave? Yeah, we need to make sure that for the next person they know what needs to be done. So I was a little bit later getting here this morning than I liked because I was spending some time with the hotel this morning, telling them about what they needed to do to make sure that their hotel was working. So, and sometimes it takes time, but I consider it paying forward that, you know, I may not come back to that hotel ever again, but I would hope that the next person with a disability that needed it would have better access. And that's a responsibility and a challenge that I give all of you. It is all of our responsibility to assure that we make sure that we put the ADA in action. Because remember, there's no ADA police. There isn't. It's all got by complaint. So if you aren't actively engaged with the business and recommending things that can make it better and more accessible, then sometimes we're part of the problem, right? You know, they may feel that nobody notices or cares, or they really just had no thought about it. And even though it's been a law for 25 years, we still have people who said, I didn't know I was supposed to do that. So we've got some tools for you that we'll talk about later that we brought, that we want to make sure you're using to make sure that you're part of the solution. When we talk about removing barriers, in this picture we show the bagel shack before, it's got one small step. And afterwards, they have eliminated that step by making a recessed entrance and making it a ramp. So it doesn't even come out into the public right away into the sidewalk, but they ramped it internally. There's a lot of things that can be done to make sure that a business is fully accessible. When I worked in state government, I worked in Annapolis during the legislative session. And some of you may have been to Annapolis. It's like around here, it's very old, historic. And none of the buildings are very accessible. They all have steps. and one day we went out to lunch and we passed restaurant after restaurant that had one step. But it was like, well, maybe I'll just find one that's accessible. So we went 5 or 6 blocks passing all these great restaurants, but convinced we were going to find one that was accessible. So we eventually did, and someone didn't do a great job on a ramp, but they had a ramp, so I was able to get in. That was a wonderful restaurant. And I never would have gone to it, nor would any of my colleagues, because there were all kinds of other ones that were inaccessible that they would have gone to. But we went and we found it, and we went back again and back again because it was accessible. So even if I couldn't join them immediately, if they thought I could join them later, they'd go there so that I could get in. We paid for that ramp that summer or that session by the fact that we used it a lot, right? And because we were there, we kept going back. And they got a lot of business because they were a good restaurant. And because they made the effort that none of those other restaurants did to be fully accessible. And we talked about the pyramid effect. That one act created a huge pyramid of people who know that now that restaurant was fully accessible. So just that effort increased their business.
Yeah, I just have a quick comment and a question also, because like you said before, I'm an architect. So when you install a ramp, you have the 1-to-2 ratio. So for example, actually on your after, that's actually not legal because of the way the ramp is pushing out into the sidewalk. So that's usually a big concern when people do want to maybe create a ramp, but the length of the ramp and where the ramp is located could become, because now that's an obstacle into the right of way. If you look at, you know, so that's, you know, it's such a difficult sometimes, you know, you have to weigh, and like you were saying, the ramp that this restaurant created was not ideally. That leads me to believe that it probably did not meet the 1-to-2, so actually somebody could have challenged that owner for not having a legal ramp. Sometimes it gets so, it's so difficult to try, especially historic or older buildings in established, you know, neighborhoods that have, don't have the wider sidewalks and those kinds of things. So I'm just a point of, sometimes if you really want to, but it's very difficult.
Oh, absolutely, and many times it's been said, it is not readily achievable.
Right.
And this is actually a Department of Justice.
I know, I'm surprised that they have that picture because you see what I'm saying, though, right? It's protruding into the right of way. So somebody with a cane could hit it and, yeah.
Now that may also be, that may be a temporary ramp that didn't describe. And that's one of the things that we suggest, and a lot of times we suggest, for a block of businesses that they have a portable ramp that they share and they put it down when someone needs it. And when you do that, you can do a doorbell, push the doorbell, and it shows, you know, even though it's not the best symbol, it's the only one we really have, a wheelchair symbol, and a doorbell. And you can go to any home center, you know, hardware store, and get a remote doorbell and use the standard signs you can also get at a hardware store and have that remote doorbell ring. And then they can come out and either provide you the service on the street, and we'll show you that, or to put in a, put down the ramp and be able to use that and then pull it up so that it's not an obstruction into the public right of way where someone could trip. And do that. But that's an interesting comment, and I, as I said, I just literally cut and pasted this out of the small business primer that is part of the Department of Justice's regulatory documents for assistance for businesses. But there's a lot of different ways that ramps can be done, and it can be challenging to do effectively. I know the city of Pittsburgh is doing some really exciting things. They have what they call a one-step program, and they have trying to promote services. They have looked at their regulatory environment for businesses becoming accessible, and for a business that only needs to remove one step, they have streamlined their regulatory process. So the application is easy, it's inexpensive. They have design professionals that have helped businesses design the ramp, all in our efforts to encourage more accessibility for people with disabilities. And there are more and more communities who are looking at this model to encourage that removal of that one step. Because even with the 1 in 12 standard, you know, one step might be very doable. And if you have the public right-of-way or the guided support that you make it,
my question is a follow-up to the previous question. I manage a home rehab program in Virginia Beach for low-income homeowners, and one of the things that we do under that program is to make the homes more accessible when needed. But my question is, thinking back to your comment about there not being any police, when let's say a person who doesn't go through our program wants to have accessibility improvements, they hire a contractor to make them. How does the homeowner know that the contractor has met ADA standards?
Well, first of all, homeowners are not covered under the ADA, right? Because remember, we talked about the Fair Housing Act. Private homes do not have a requirement unless there is a state or local regulation that talks about homeowner accessibility. And we're seeing some of that happen across the country. And it's very exciting. There's a movement called Visitability, where they're saying with new home design, where they're going to require an accessible entrance and an accessible power room on the first floor so that somebody with a disability can visit you. You know, come for coffee or for dinner and be able to go to the bathroom and get in and out. So that doesn't mean you don't have to eliminate steps in the front, that you can have a ramp on the side to get to those steps, or a side entrance, a kitchen entrance, a back door entrance that is at ground level that would allow somebody with a disability to get in and out. And more we're finding that homes are being designed and built with the concept of being able to accommodate eventually a first floor bedroom so that people can age in place and not have to go to the second floor. So there's a lot of interest in making sure that homes are being designed more accessible and usable, but it's not under the ADA. The ADA doesn't require that because it's a homeowner's issue. But to your point about contractors, the onus is on whoever hires the contractor. And so we really encourage people to spend time and ask what their background and skill set is. Ask them basic questions about, you know, years ago we developed a contractor survey question. So, you know, what is an accessible ramp? What is the standard door width? What are clear hallway widths? Those kinds of things to see if when they're interviewing a contractor, if right off the top of their head they know those answers, then you know that they're probably going to be good. Asking them how they, what reference documents they use in providing full access, who they contract with to make sure.
Yes, and I heard earlier when you had said that private homes are not covered by ADA, but standards have been set for egress, for walkways, for railings, for bathtubs, even for vanities. So if a person requests, so what you're saying is if a person requests one or more of those improvements, they really have to trust either the contractor or their own instincts in terms of whether the standards that have been set are met. Is that true?
Yes, that's exactly right. So the ADA is used as a standard, but it's not a requirement under the Americans with Disabilities Act. And it's, you know, it's a usability standard, and it's designed on ergonomics, but it is not a requirement under the ADA to do so. So just so that, you know, people are really clear about what the requirement is, that ADA does not cover individual homeowners, but we do use the ADA. You know, the ADA is kind of like Kleenex. You know, we use the same terminology, right? Not all facial tissue are Kleenex brands, but we all say Kleenex, don't we? And we all say Xerox when we mean a copier. You know, there's all of those kind of standards that we say and we use. And the ADA is like that. If we talk about anything related to people with disabilities, it's an ADA issue. It really isn't an ADA issue. It's a disability issue. And we will be referring to that. So you got to be, that's why I kind of went through the civil rights issue, is that you can see the history and the laws that developed around it, so that we have the Fair Housing Act, which also doesn't cover private homes, but it covers congregate housing. And we have the Air Carrier Access Act that covers airplanes and airline services. The airport itself is Title II or Title III, but the flying aspect is part of Air Carrier Access Act. And so that was a precursor to the ADA, so the ADA doesn't cover it. There's a lot of people who want to make sure that homes are more and more physically accessible. And so you're certainly encouraged to use standards. But one caution I have, and it's really important to know, that we talked about the 1 in 12 standard. You know, so for 1 and 2, whatever, for every inch of height, you have a foot of ramp. So for every inch of stair, you have 12 inches of ramp to make it accessible. That's minimally accessible. A lot of people can't physically push up in a manual chair a 1 in 12 ramp. If you can do 1 in 20, do it. If you can do flat, do it. I have been horrified to hear architects say, I had to really work hard to get to 1 in 12 because I had 1 in 20. But they saw 1 in 12, and so they thought that was the absolute, that we had to get it there. I was like, oh my gosh, are you kidding me? No, the goal is full access. So you can always exceed the ADA standards. And we encourage you to, but you must meet the basic standard of the ADA. So if you have to work hard to make sure that it's 1 in 12 because of the limitations you have, then it must be 1 in 12. But if you can do 1 in 16, or 1 in 18, or 1 in 20, so much the better, because it provides more access. So I encourage people to think about the ADA as the basement, all right? You can't go lower than the basement, right? You can always go higher. And we see we get higher and higher. Buildings are getting taller and taller. But you can't go lower than the basement. So the ADA standards are always going to be the basement of what we need to comply with. And then everything else we do is so much better. It's so much more that universal design that access for all, required under the ADA, but it makes it accessible for everyone. And that's really our goal. And sometimes we find that the ADA standards really still don't make it fully accessible for any number of reasons. And that's where it takes creativity. And I've never had anybody challenge me, and I've been saying this for years, so maybe it's true. The ADA, I think, is the only law that I know of that mandates creativity. Think about it. I can't think of another law that absolutely mandates creative thinking. We creatively think about reasonable accommodations for people in employment. And in the physical access, what we're talking about now, you have to creatively look at the environment and how can we apply these ramp laws or regulations if it's readily achievable. How can we do that? Now, as was mentioned, you know, this ramp sticking out like that into the public right-of-way could be a real hazard. But we've also seen ramps that have been flared out that were wonderful and didn't provide an obstacle, but allowed people entrance into the facility, and really well done. So I'm gonna presume this is a temporary ramp that shows it could be done.
I'm a designer, universal design, and looking at that, I would add plants on the inside. So, yes. But it's not reducing the right of way, it's protecting the person who's blind, not going into the ramp. So I would put the plants there. There's a creativity, universal design.
That's a real good point. You know, one of the things we talk about when we're talking about physical access is that we want to make sure that when we're providing access, we want to make sure that people who are using canes and other devices, that we identify them. And if we were going to be talking more about a lot of the physical access things, we would be talking about anything that protrudes into the clear floor space. We have some sort of identifier. And a lot of times potted plants are a great way to do that. We may put potted plants underneath an open staircase to make sure that people don't run into their head. Or for some sort of alarm system that could come out to the public right away. Or some signages or things like that. So there's a lot of ways that we can be very creative to make sure that we're providing access to one group of people and then creating a barrier for others. A good example of that is the detectable warnings that you see on ramps. Those detectable warnings are designed for folks who are using canes to be able to detect the fact that we're changing altitude and we're going to be going into and transitioning into the street. So those detectable warnings allow people who were blind or with visual disabilities, because the detectable warnings, those little bumps, are a different color. So it warns people. So that if we did that without those detectable warnings, some people, they're so well done, sometimes the ramps are so well done and transitioned well, that you don't realize that you've gone off of the curb and into the street. And so we've had to consider all different kinds of disabilities in order for our public rights of way to be fully accessible for people with all different kinds of disabilities. We have a question.
One more question. It's because it's time for break, for lunch, to continue our conversation.
Can you wait? Okay.
Mary, you're okay?
Absolutely.
Okay, I think the lunch is delivered, and we'll come back in about 10 minutes, 15 minutes, and we'll start our panel discussion. Thank you very much.